Hello everyone, let's make dental education easy and interesting too. So today we would be watching the part 2 of the topic dental ceramics. But if you have not yet watched part 1, I request you to watch it first for better understanding. And if you have not yet subscribed to our channel, please subscribe us right now. Also share these videos with all your friends. Comment and tell us your feedback, and also if you are benefited even a bit from our video, please give us a thumbs up. It motivates us a lot. So in this lecture, we will be studying first how the porcelain is manufactured. Then we would be studying in detail about glaze, both overglaze and self-glaze. Then we will be studying about how the strengthening of the brittle porcelain material is done. This is done by three methods. First, by introducing residual compressive stress. Secondly, by interruption of crack propagation. And then proper designing of the restoration reduces the brittleness of the material. Then we will be studying about how the fabrication of the ceramic restoration is done. We will study what is matrix, how the porcelain restoration is builded up, how it is condensed, what is firing, how it is cooled, what is glazing, shrinkage and porosity in detail. The process of manufacturing porcelain is also called as fritting. When powder is mixed with distilled water, the porcelain powder is mixed with distilled water, it forms a plastic mass. Now this plastic mass is quenched in cooled water, it is immersed in water, and this quenching or cooling of this plastic mass results in cracking, which causes fracture of the material. Now this fractured material is then ground into fine particles, and thus the porcelain is produced. Now what is glaze? Glaze can be an overglaze or a self-glaze. In overglaze, the ceramic powders are mixed with certain amount of glass modifiers, which is more, and addition of this more amount of glass modifiers reduces the fusion temperature of the porcelain. Now this overglaze is then applied on the porcelain restoration. This is the porcelain restoration. This red color is the overglaze which is applied over this restoration, and application of this overglaze gives an impervious glossy surface to the restoration. The coefficient of thermal expansion of the overglaze should be slightly lower than that of the porcelain body. Remember this. Now, what is self-glaze? All the constituents of the porcelain frit are melted together. This form a single phase of glass. And such porcelain are called as self-glazed porcelain. This self-glazed porcelain have better chemical durability due to higher fusion temperature. Now, what is strengthening of the ceramics? Ceramics are brittle material. They have lower tensile strength and sufficient enough compressive strength. Now, to overcome this disadvantage of brittleness, three methods are used. First, introduction of residual compressive stress into surface of the material. Then, interruption of crack propagation. And third method is proper designing of the restoration. Let us study each of this method in detail. Now, for how the residual compressive stress is introduced into the material. Now, if this is a porcelain restoration, if the surface of this porcelain restoration is treated such that the residual compressive stresses are introduced onto the surface, these residual compressive stresses are more than the tensile stress. Therefore, the restoration would not get fractured under tensile stress. Now, there are certain techniques of introduction of these residual compressive stresses. First is the first method is the chemical tempering method, which is also called as the ion exchange method, in which there is an ionic exchange between the sodium ion and the potassium ion. Now, this sodium ion is smaller in diameter while the potassium ion is larger in diameter by around 35%. That is, the potassium ion is 35% larger in size than the sodium ion. Now, this sodium ion goes away and this sodium ion is replaced by this potassium ion. Now, the area occupied by this sodium ion is lesser than that of the area of this potassium ion. So, this potassium ion gets squeezed into this smaller space. This squeezing is called as stuffing, and this squeezing creates a residual compressive stress on the glass surface. Hope this is clear to all of you. A difference in the size between the sodium ion and the potassium ion causes this stuffing and introduction of the compressive stresses. The second method is that of thermal tempering. As the name implies, thermal tempering is something related to the temperature. Now, the porcelain restoration is rapidly cooled or quenched by immersing it in water, in very cold water, as a result of which the surface of the restoration is cooled rapidly while the core, it still remains soft. A rigid skin is formed on the periphery while the core is still soft. Now, as time elapses and this core become also solidifies, there is shrinkage of the core. This decreases the tensile stress of the core, as a result of which there is residual compressive stress on the surface or the outer skin of the restoration. Thus, residual compressive stresses are introduced by thermal tempering. The third method of this is the coefficient of thermal expansion mismatch. This technique is used when ceramic and metal are used together. The ceramic and the metal are mixed and they are heated and cooled together. The ceramic and the metal are not mixed, but they are heated and cooled together. Now, if this is a restoration, that is, the ceramic is present on the outer surface while the metal forms the core, the metal has increased coefficient of thermal expansion. So, when cooled, the metal, it gets contracted. And it contracts more than that of ceramics. Because of this contraction of the metal, residual compressive stress is introduced on the outer ceramic surface. Now, the next method to reduce the brittleness of ceramic is the interruption of crack propagation. In this technique, the ceramics are reinforced with a dispersed phase of different material. Now, this dispersed phase is a material that should be capable of hindering the crack from propagating through the material. Now, this dispersed phase is of two types. The dispersed phase that absorbs the energy and prevents the crack propagation, and the dispersed phase which Change the crystal structure under stress. Let us study each of this dispersion phase in detail. Now, the dispersion phase that absorbs energy include a toughened crystalline material like Al2O3 or alumina added in particulate form. In small particles, they are added to the glass. Now, you can see this is the glass, and this dispersed phase of alumina is added to it in the form of red colored particles. Now, what happened is that due to addition of this dispersed phase, the glass becomes toughened, and the crack which occur cannot penetrate through this alumina particle. Suppose this is a crack which is propagating. When it reaches the alumina particle, it cannot propagate further, and thus there is interruption in the crack propagation. Now, dichor is an example of which contains mica and glass particles. Mica interrupts crack propagation. The coefficient of thermal expansion between the crystalline material and the glass material should be very, very close. So, the crystalline material which is used are aluminia and zirconia. Now, the second type of dispersion phase is the dispersion phase that changes the crystal structure under stress. The crystalline material which is used is partially stabilized zirconia. When stress is applied, this partially stabilized zirconia undergo transformation. Suppose stress is applied here, the partially stab, and this green color is the partially stabilized zirconia particle. Now, when stress is applied to it, this PSZ or partially stabilized zirconia undergo transformation. It undergoes transformation, and the energy that is required to allow crack propagation is used for the transformation of this PSZ particle. So, the crack propagation is reduced. Now, designing of the restoration also reduces the crack, the brittleness of the material. Sharp angles should be avoided. The thickness of the porcelain should be uniform, and the favorable occlusion should be attained for long life of the porcelain restoration. Now, let us study how the fabrication of ceramic restoration is done. The porcelain powder is mixed with liquid or distilled water, and it forms a plastic mass. This plastic mass is then condensed to form a restoration. The restoration is then fired at increased temperature, and this is called as sintering. Now, when porcelain restoration is fired, the mass shrinks and flows. Therefore, the built up mass has to be supported, and this support is done with the help of the matrix. The matrix supports the restoration, and this matrix should have a higher fusion temperature than the porcelain. Now, this is a diagrammatic representation of what is the matrix. It is nothing but a platinum foil which is adapted to the die. This platinum foil should have of thickness 0.001 centimeter is applied to the die to form a wrinkle-free matrix. Metal coping of suitable design and alloy could also be used as a matrix. Now, the building up of the porcelain, the powder is mixed with liquid to form a plastic mass. Now, this plastic mass is applied over the matrix with the help of a brush. Now, the crown is built up in layers. Now the condensation, the process by which the pack the process of packing the powder particles together and removing the water is called as condensation. Proper condensation gives dense packing, which reduces the shrinkage and reduces the porosity. There are various methods of condensation, like the vibration method, spatulation method, brush technique, ultrasonic vibrations, gravitational method, and whipping. All methods are equally good, but be careful that the porcelain restoration should not dry out, as powder particles are held together due to surface tension of water. Firing, which is also called as sintering, is carried out for fusion of the porcelain particles. After condensation, the compacted mass supported by the matrix is placed on the fire clay tray. This firing causes 30-40% shrinkage. The heating in the furnace should be gradual. This is a diagrammatic representation of the furnace which is used for porcelain restoration. During firing or sintering, the porcelain undergoes through various stages, and these stages are called as bisque stages or the biscuit stages. There are three types of these stages: the low, medium, and high. Let us study what happens in each stage. In the low bisque stage, the material is very rigid, it is very porous, there is little shrinkage in the restoration, and there is lack of adhesion or cohesion between the particles, and also there is no translucency and glaze. Then in the medium bisque stage, the restoration is still porous, there is a definite amount of shrinkage which occurs, there is complete cohesion of the powder particles, and lack of translucency and glaze. Now in the high bisque stage, there is still a little porosity, but complete shrinkage has occurred. The surface of the restoration becomes smooth, but there is no glaze present. Now, work can be removed at any stage from the furnace and additions can be made. But if there is less number of firings, it will increase the strength of the restoration. While if the there is increase in the number of firings, it reduces the life of restoration and it gives over translucency to the restoration. Now, the cooling should be done slowly and uniformly. If it is not uniform, it will result in cracking of the restoration and loss of strength. Glazing is done to provide a smooth and glossy surface to the restoration. It enhances the aesthetic and improves the hygiene. The glaze powder is mixed with liquid and applied over the smoothened crown, and then it is fired at lower temperature. The glazed porcelain is much stronger than the unglazed porcelain, but if glaze is removed in the later stage, there is decrease in the tensile strength by 50%. Then the shrinkage of the restoration occurs up to 40%, and this shrinkage is due to water loss. So while building up the ceramic restoration, oversized restoration is first made because it undergoes 40% shrinkage. The porosity, it occurs due to air inclusion during firing. The air voids, it decreases the translucency of the restoration. So these air voids should be avoided. This porosity can be reduced by firing in partial vacuum. So here we complete with the part 2 of dental ceramics. In the next lecture, which will be the concluding part of the dental ceramics, is the part 3. I request you all to watch all the 3 parts in sequence, not only of this topic dental ceramics, but other topics which we have already uploaded in our playlist. Please go through our playlist on dental materials to find lectures on all the important topics. That's all for now. Please subscribe to our channel if you have not yet done, and happy studying.